sunshine on my shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry. Sunshine on the water looks so lovely. Almost always makes me high. If I had a day that I could give you, I'd give to you a day just like today. If I had a song that I could sing for you, I'd sing a song to make you feel this way. My shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry.
Hello, everybody. This is Gvideo34. You're probably sick of me talking about John Denver so much. And this will be my last video talking about the man himself. You know, I just wanted to say, I didn't realize how much influence he had on my life until I did some real soul searching the last couple of days. Like I said in previous videos, he was involved with NASA a lot. He campaigned for the Clintons when Bill Clinton was big back in the day. He wanted to be a part of the Challenger, and he trained rigorously to be on the Challenger and got denied for some reason. I think we all know the reasons, but like I said, he didn't exist. He was dead. So somehow NASA knew this, and that's why they never, you know, let him go on that. Or maybe they knew the Challenger itself. I've heard conspiracy theories that the Challenger itself was nothing but a sham. It was some kind of false flag event or something. Nobody died. They wanted to make a political statement or something with it, which kind of sucks if that's the truth, because the Challenger, like I might have mentioned before in other videos, was a big deal to us kids back then. They hyped up so much about the teachers being on the Challenger, and supposedly John Denver was supposed to be on there, which I never heard a damn thing about until now, which is a shame. I mean, that's the Mandela effect for you, but it was a big deal, and for them to make a joke out of something so serious in my life kind of hurts me. But it is what it is. This is our government, our secret government, or whoever the fuck they are. I have no idea who they are, who's running the show around here. Maybe they're just idiot archons, I don't know. But this is who we're fucking dealing with here. these people that manipulate stuff behind the scenes, you know, and they took this event that was personal to me and they manipulated it and blew it up, and people say that the teacher and everybody else, they shipped them to another planet or something. I don't know. I don't believe that myself. That's a conspiracy theory. I believe anything's possible in my universe. I mean, my whole world is turned upside down. I have memories of another Earth, but as far as that one goes, I don't really put much stock into it, even though it could be true. All I just know is that molded my life. I'll never forget that day when those people died on the Challenger. It was really depressing. It would have been even worse, though, if, you know, well, actually, no, he wouldn't have been alive. I mean, it would have been even worse if the dead man, John Denver, which was dead, went on the Challenger and got blown up, but he was dead already, you know. I know it's not funny, but it's just ridiculous that they're saying he's alive and he was going to be on the Challenger, you know, but it is what it is, and I don't know how to process that right now, or I don't know how to process this or any future events. I don't know what the hell is going on, to be honest with you. But, you know, all I know is if he really lived to be 97, I would have known it. I mean, not 97, lived to the year 1997, my apologies. I would have known it. He would have influenced my life in so many ways that it would have impacted my life. I mean, if you watch movies like The Butterfly Effect, any little change in your life will impact your life in the future. Well, him being a part of the Clinton campaign would have, if I'd known about it, it would have impacted my life to this day. Right now, I hate Democrats and Republicans, which is probably smart of me because they're probably both crooks, you know, like the conspiracy theory people say. You know, they're probably just, they have people's hands in their ass controlling them, probably. And, you know, but still, I mean, if I knew back then in 97 that John Denver was campaigning for the Clintons, if it really happened, I mean, which I know it didn't, I would have been a Democrat today. I would have been a staunch Democrat. I would be campaigning for Obama right now. And you're telling me that's not a fucking life impact? You're telling me that him campaigning for the Clintons isn't a big deal? I mean, it would be to me. I would, right now, I'd be a staunch Democrat. You wouldn't have an argument against me. That's how staunch Democrat I would be. I'd kick a Republican's ass right now. That's how dedicated I would be, because John Denver the man campaigned for Clinton. And that's just how it goes, but it never happened, and you people can say it did all you want, but I know it's bullshit. And tell me otherwise, but I don't believe it, and that's not my reality. I'm from whatever fucking Earth there is out there. Earth 1, Earth 2, Earth give a fuck. Earth don't give a fuck. I don't know where the fuck it is I'm from. But wherever the fuck I'm from, he's not fucking in it. And I don't damn well, and pardon my language, but that's just, that pisses me off. I know damn well that's just the way it is, and I gotta move on. But last year, I didn't listen to my Muppet Christmas album. Last year I just kind of gave up on life, because you know, life for me last year was pretty bad. I mean, just everything, all these changes are happening. I found out I had to move, and I had to make all these changes in my life, and I was really I just gave up on life for a while, and up until now, I mean, I've made a difference right now. But you see my videos, I mean, I made a comeback. I got free of these archons, and I'm doing good right now, and I'm happy because I'm smiling. You don't know what's going on right now, but I'm actually smiling like the the fucking, what do you call that, the Lucky Charms leprechaun inside, because I know now that I'm on the right path. I'm doing the right thing now. Before, I didn't know what path I was on. I didn't know if I was on a good path. I did something horrible that affected my life, and it put me on a path I thought to hell, and it put me on a path where I didn't think I'd come back from. But apparently, I'm on the good path now, and I'm going to make things right. It feels good to be on the good path. It really does. Especially when you thought you were on the wrong path the whole time. But events led and combined each other, and eventually they skyrocketed me to the right path. And now I'm on the right path, and I couldn't be happier, and I'm just saying, you know, this year I will be listening to that John Denver album. I might be even celebrating holidays now. Last year I could care about holidays. I mean, it's not just the fact that I had to move. My life was, something happened to me in the last couple of years that I just don't understand. I mean, I think it's depression. I don't know, but it could be, because I've been told by a family member who runs in my family, but sometimes it does hit me hard. But I think it did hit me, and over the years, it just, I'd stopped liking the movies I used to like, and I stopped liking the music I used to like. And eventually, it affected Christmas too, and Halloween. I just didn't love Halloween the way I used to, excuse me, or Christmas. But I am happy to say that I have the Halloween spirit now, and I am going to listen to my Muppet Christmas album come Christmas. Hopefully I'm with you guys. I know damn well I will be, but I'm going to fight my ass off now to keep this positive road and stay on the right road and make sure everything's good. I can't say I won't be sad. I mean, listen to the album, it'll remind me that I missed 20 years of the guy, of John Denver's life, that could have affected me. But maybe I won't be too sad, because I know it never happened. I know the man died before or around the time of my birth, or a little bit after my birth, or when I was a little baby. So I know in my heart that's when he died, and it was in 1997. So, and I know for a fact I'm a huge fan of NASA, and I would have, you know, liked him even more for that too as well, because John Denver was a big fan of NASA as well. So I actually went to Cape Canaveral. God knows what happened to the pictures, but my family and my parents moved, and I guess they lost custody of the house or something, and a lot of pictures got trapped in the house that we used to live in. I don't know if they own that picture anymore, but I had my picture taken with, I think it was an astronaut, I'm not sure. Cape Canaveral is like 1986, I believe. And I would took a picture with an astronaut, and you know, it was amazing. And you know, I've liked this ever since. And you know, I've been a fan of, not a huge fan of NASA, but I, you know, I don't like too many of the movies, but I mean, I like the space program, and I wish it would continue. And but it seems like, I have to go off topic, it seems like Obama doesn't give a shit about the space program, which is totally uncharacteristic for a Democrat, since JFK was the man that started the space program. So I don't understand where he's headed with the space program myself. I heard they're doing stuff with it, and I have no idea. But last time I heard, the Russians were taking it over, which is a shame, since NASA was so great. But I could be wrong. I mean, I'm not in the know of NASA right now, but you know, I was hoping, you know, America would be better in the space game than what they are now. But I don't know. It's just, I know a lot of people, and like a man that some people hate, I'm like meh with, I don't care, but his name's Richard Hoagland, and he's big into NASA, I believe, right, from what I hear. I mean, well, actually, I'm bullshitting. Yeah, I know he's big into NASA, because I used to listen to him all the time, coast to coast, and I gotta start listening to that one these days, but ever since George Snorri took over, you know, the guy puts you to sleep at night, you know, I don't listen to it as much, and I'm never up at that hour, so I don't subscribe to coast because I'm dead ass broke, so, you know. One of these days I'll listen to Hoagland again, but he was all hopeful for, you know, NASA with Obama when Obama came in, and I think Obama might have let him down, I don't know, but you know, if that's the case, you know, I hope the next president will further advance these space shuttles. I used to call these space shuttles we got now the rust buckets of the universe, because and you look at it, they're like, oh yeah, no, and what I used to call them were an over-glorified easy bake oven. that's what, because they're just so horrible. Look at it, it's 2016, we got a cell phone, this phone I'm talking to you on right now, it's more powerful than our space station. That should tell you a lot. I mean, right in the, you know, that should tell you everything right there and the whole shebang, you know. How, what life's about, you know, we've got a cell phone that's more powerful than anything, but we can't, but our priorities aren't on a space shuttle or a spaceship that's like the Enterprise, so, you know, maybe if we got our heads out of our asses and got a spaceship like the Enterprise, it'd be good, but I guess that's not the agenda in place right now. Maybe the next president
Bullshit.
Will take care of that, who knows. If Hillary doesn't becomes president, just doesn't fall off the podium and die, you know, maybe she'll handle the space program and make it a better place, you know. You know, instead of being known for the lady to just cough to death and just fall off the podium and choke to death or something, I don't know. I'm just being silly now. Well, anyways, you know, this is the last video, and I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Man, I can talk 15 minutes, I see right now on the timer, so I better get off. I talked to you right off enough, so enjoy my last video. This is going to be it unless one of my friends comes like Doc Brown's like, Gabe, you're never going to believe this. Such as, they died at this age, or man, the package of Oreos changed from Oreo to O-R-E... I don't give a fuck or something like that, you know, but until that happens again, you know, there you go, swearing like a damn sailor again, you know. I know I was a pirate in the last life, but I'll knock it off. Anyways, I'm taking off. You guys have a great day. I'm going to go get something to eat. Have fun, you know. Stay safe and stay strong during this Mandela effect, and hopefully it doesn't overrun you know, or take you over, or, you know, drive you nuts, you know, like it does me a little bit, but I don't go too crazy, though. I, you know, like Bane said, you know, you merely adapted the insanity. I was born into it. Good night, everybody. Just remember that.
On October 12, 1997, Denver was killed when his experimental Rutan Long EZ plane, aircraft registration number N555JD, crashed into Monterey Bay near Pacific Grove, California, while making a series of touch-and-go landings at the nearby Monterey Peninsula Airport. The National Transportation Safety Board's NTSB accident ID is LAX98FA008. Denver was the only occupant of the aircraft. The crash badly disfigured Denver's head and body, making identification impossible by dental records, so records of his fingerprints were used to confirm that the fallen pilot was indeed the singer. A pilot with over 2,700 hours of experience, Denver had pilot license ratings for single-engine land and sea, multi-engine land, glider, and instrument. He also held a type rating in his Learjet. He had recently purchased the Long EZ aircraft and had taken a half-hour checkout flight with the aircraft the day before the accident. Denver was not legally permitted to fly at the time of the accident. In years prior, Denver had had a number of drunk driving arrests. In 1996, nearly a year before the accident, the Federal Aviation Administration had learned that Denver had failed to maintain sobriety by failing to abstain entirely from alcohol, and thus the FAA was compelled to revoke his medical certification. The accident, however, was not influenced by alcohol use, as there was no trace of alcohol or other drugs in Denver's body at autopsy. Post-accident investigation by the NTSB showed that the leading cause of the accident was Denver's inability to switch fuel tanks during flight. The quantity of fuel had been depleted during the plane's transfer to Monterey and in several brief practice takeoffs and landings performed by Denver at the airport immediately prior to the final flight. His newly purchased experimental Rutan had an unusual fuel selector valve handle configuration. Intended by the plane's designer to be located between the pilot's legs, the fuel selector had instead been placed by the plane's builder behind the left shoulder of the pilot, with the fuel gauge also behind the pilot's seat and thus not visible to the person at the controls. An NTSB interview with the aircraft mechanic servicing Denver's plane revealed that he and Denver had discussed the inaccessibility of the cockpit fuel selector valve handle and its resistance to being turned. Before the flight, Denver and the mechanic had attempted to extend the reach of the handle, using a pair of vice grip pliers. However, this did not solve the problem, as the pilot could still not reach the handle while strapped into his seat. NTSB investigators' post-accident investigation showed that given the positioning of the fuel selector valves, switching the craft's fuel tanks required a pilot to turn his body 90 degrees to reach the valve. This created a natural tendency to extend one's right foot against the right rudder pedal to support oneself while turning in the seat, causing the aircraft to yaw, move off course, and pitch up. According to the mechanic, after he had noted to Denver that the fuel sight gauges were visible only to the rear cockpit occupant, Denver asked him about the quantity of fuel shown. The mechanic told Denver that he had less than half in the right tank and less than a quarter in the left tank. The mechanic then provided Denver with an inspection mirror so that he could look over his shoulder at the fuel sight gauges. The mirror was later recovered in the wreckage. Denver told the mechanic that he would use the autopilot in flight, if necessary, to hold the airplane level while he turned the fuel selector valve. Denver declined an offer to take on additional fuel, telling the mechanic that he would only be flying for about 1 hour. The NTSB interviewed 20 witnesses of Denver's last flight. Six of them had observed the planes crash into the ocean near Point Pinos. Four of the witnesses indicated that the airplane was originally heading west, five of them observed the airplane in a steep bank, with four of those five reporting the bank was to the right, north. 12 witnesses saw the airplane in a steep nose-down descent. Witnesses estimated the plane's height at 350 to 500 feet while heading toward the shoreline. Eight of the witnesses said that they heard a pop or backfire, along with a reduction in the engine noise level just before the airplane descended into the water. In addition to Denver's failure to refuel the plane prior to takeoff and his subsequent loss of control while attempting to switch fuel tanks, The NTSB determined there were several other key factors that led to the accident. Primary among these was the inadequate transition training on this type of aircraft by the pilot, and the builder's decision to locate the unmarked fuel selector handle in a difficult-to-access location. Following its investigation, the board issued recommendations regarding the requirement and enforcement of mandatory training standards for pilots engaged in operating experimental aircraft. The board also emphasized the importance of mandatory ease of access to all controls, including fuel selectors and fuel gauges, in all aircraft.
All my bags are packed, I'm ready to go. I'm standing here outside your door. I hate to wake you up to say goodbye, but the dawn is breaking, it's early morn. The taxi's waiting, he's blown his horn. Already I'm so lonesome I could die. So kiss me and smile for me, tell me that you'll wait for me, hold me like you'll never let me go. 'Cause I'm leaving on a jet plane, don't know when I'll be back again. Oh babe, I hate to go. There's so many times I've let you down, so many times I played around. I tell you now, they don't mean a thing. Every place I go, I'll think of you. Every song I sing, I'll sing for you. When I come back, I'll bring your wedding ring. So kiss me and smile for me, tell me that you'll wait for me, hold me like you'll never let me go. 'Cause I'm leaving on a jet plane, don't know when I'll be back again. Oh babe, I hate to go. The time has come to leave you. One more time, let me kiss you. Then close your eyes and I'll be on my way. Dream about the days to come when I won't have to leave alone. About the times I won't have to say. Kiss me and smile for me, tell me that you'll wait for me, hold me like you'll never let me go. 'Cause I'm leaving on a jet plane, don't know when I'll be back again. Oh babe, I hate to go. I hate to go.
Sunshine on my shoulders,
makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry. Sunshine on the water looks so lovely. Almost always makes me high. If I had a day that I could give you, I'd give to you a day just like today. If I had a song that I could sing for you, I'd sing a song to make you feel this way. My shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry. Sunshine on the water so lovely. Sunshine almost always makes me high. If I had a tale that I could tell you, tell a tale sure to make you smile. If I had a wish that I could wish for you, I'd make a wish for sunshine. My shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry. Sunshine on the water looks so lovely. Almost all the time makes me high. Sunshine almost always.
Country Music Entertainer of the Year is the top honor for the current active country music performer. And to present it tonight, last year's Entertainer of the Year, ladies and gentlemen, the Silver Fox, the fantastic Mr. Charlie Rich.
Ooh, I got time. As a matter of fact, it's the most beautiful thing in the world right here. Most beautiful thing in the world. Thank you very much. I know the people who are up for it are suffering right now, the way I did last year. I mean suffering, you know, like gut. The nominees for the Country Music Entertainer of the Year are John Denver, Waylon Jennings. The reason I'm talking so correct because I just got back from London. I'd rather be in Nashville. Loretta Lynn. Loretta, would you like to go out tonight? Ronnie Millsap. First time I saw Ronnie, our bandstand broke through. 18-foot bandstand. Bang! And my friend from Arkansas, Mississippi, Helena, and anywhere he wanted to be, Mr. Conway Twitty, the winner. My friend, Mr. John Denver.
I don't know what to say. I thank my good friend Jerry Weintraub, my manager. Hiya, Jerry. Mom and Dad, I hope you're proud of me. Annie, I love you. And my friends, I love singing for you. I thank you very, very much. Country music fans everywhere, and boy, there are a lot of them here in Australia. Thank you, my friends. Thank you very much. Wow.
It's been a great evening, Charlie, and it's nearly time to say goodnight.
Now, not without regard for the bicentennial, Glenn.
You're right.
Now, without any regard, I'll tell you, let's have... It seems fitting that we call on a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame, and the man known far and wide is Mr. Nashville, and that's up next after this word from Kraft.
Right.
Tonight's program has been brought to you by Kraft. To get all of tonight's complete...
Oh, let me chop it, baby. You got to let me chop it.
Ooh-wee-oo. Thanks for washing my car, Rook. You know what this is?
A chamois cloth.
Ha! Lucky guess. I just lost a buck. To myself. Think that's funny, do you?
Yeah, I do. I heard something funny about how you got suspended. Something about a school bus full of kids.
Oh, you heard that, did you? Let me tell you another funny story, New Jack. Back in 74, the great Charlie Rich was named Country Musician of the Year. Then in 75, he had to hand the award off to the new one. And you know who that was? Mr. Sunshine on My Goddamn Shoulders, John Denver.
Really?
Can you believe it?
Wow.
Replaced by John fucking Denver.
Amazing.
Yeah. Well, I'll be damaged if Mr. Rich didn't pull out his cigarette lighter right there and light that award on fire in front of everyone. You get it?
So you're saying, can you set my country music award on fire?
I'm saying when my suspension's up, you better watch your ass.
Or you'll light my ass on fire.
Want to go, mister?
Yeah, yeah.
You want to take one?
Oh, you smell pretty.
Oh, yeah?
Make your first move, baby.
Oh, yeah, it's allowing.
Hey, hey, hey. Hate to break up the honky convention, but we got a 1092. You want to take this one, Rod?
Hell yeah.
I bet you do.
Go.
Nice wax job, Rook.
Thanks, sir.
You...
On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a partridge in a pear tree.
And on the second day of Christmas, my true love gave to me two turtle doves
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the third day of Christmas, my true love gave to me three French hens,
two turtle doves
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the fourth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me four calling birds, three French hens,
two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the fifth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me five blue trees.
Four calling birds, three French hens,
two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the sixth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me six geese a-laying.
Four calling birds, three French hens,
two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the seventh day of Christmas, my true love gave to me seven swans a-swimming,
six geese a-laying,
five blue-green.
Four calling birds, three French hens,
two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the eighth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me eight maids a-milking,
six geese a-laying,
five blue-green.
Four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the ninth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me nine ladies dancing,
eight maids a-milking,
seven, six geese a-laying,
in a pear tree.
On the tenth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me ten birds a-leaping,
nine ladies dancing,
eight maids a-milking,
what? Six geese a-laying,
five
blue-greens. Four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the 11th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me 11 pipers piping,
10 lords a-leaping,
9 ladies dancing,
8 maids a-milking,
7 swans a-swimming,
6 geese a-laying,
5 blue-greens.
4 calling birds, 3 French hens,
2 turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the 12th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me
11 pipers piping,
10 lords a-leaping,
9 ladies dancing,
8 maids a-milking,
7 swans a-swimming,
6 geese a-laying,
4
calling birds, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree.
That was wonderful, you guys. Merry Christmas, everybody. Fozzie, you got it.